So these are how to create a negotiation table, which will show you arguments from both sides. And this is a great way to prep for your negotiation call. You know, we should be doing this already, even without ChatGPT, is kind of thinking about what am I going to say? What's the other side most likely going to say in response? And then having your negotiation points prepared in advance. So kind of like it did for the explanatory comments, ChatGPT organizes this information really nicely for us. And Laura is going to show us that.
Yeah. And here's just so in case people want to see when you're a plus subscriber, you can go here. I can use this. And now the reason that I might want to use 3.5 instead of 4 is because I have a cap of 50 messages every 3 hours. And yes, I have hit that. So then I've got to switch back to the other model. Over here, you can actually see my history of different things that I have searched for. So you can even see I have one for this presentation today. So now if we go over to this other tab, this is a shared chat. So one of the, I guess, newer features, I don't know, ChatGPT is new. You can share your chats with people. Unfortunately, it is not interactive yet. So I was so excited when I saw that you could share a chat. I was like, oh my gosh, can I do like a chat with someone else? This would be great. But if someone were to go and continue this conversation, I can't see what you've added to it. Maybe someday. So this is where a termination and SAS agreement. So I said, what I did with this is I wanted to build out a table, but I wanted to see what ChatGPT's understanding was first, right? Like, what does it know about termination for convenience? And so I'm really trying to prime it here and doing it kind of painstakingly. And the point of this just kind of to show you, you'll have a link to this. Everyone can access this. So I said, hey, can you please explain a termination for convenience clause from both the customer and the vendor slash provider's perspective? And it says, sure, here's the customer perspective. This is what they think about a termination for convenience clause. And it gives you, again, presented really easily. You can scan it. Here's the vendor's perspective, some things to think about. And then to balance this, it also thinks about balancing it. Hey, here's some other considerations. Then I took it from both points of view. So I said, from a customer's perspective, what are some concerns or points of negotiation around this clause? And it did that from the customer's perspective. Again, you're not supposed to read it right now. Sorry, I'm scrolling through a lot of text. I also asked from the vendor's point of view, so you can see that it has all of that. So I said, all right, it seems to have some thoughts, which are exciting. So I asked it here, can you generate some arguments a provider might use to advocate for a termination for convenience clause, and then counter arguments from the customer? And then can you put it in a table so it's easy to read? And I did that all in one prompt, and it said, sure, here you go. So it put all the provider's arguments, the customer's counter arguments, and then it tied these together about costs, right? Recovery of costs versus cost burden. And so you can see it has this. Then I said, okay, cool. That's great. But I want to get to solutions, right? If we're negotiating contracts, we need to get to solutions. So can you actually take those argument, counter argument, and give us some solutions? And it did, which is pretty cool. So now we've got like recovery of cost burden. How about you do prorated termination fees? That kind of works for both parties, right, in their concerns. And so I said, great. Okay, here's my actual termination for convenience clause. Can you please update the table taking into consideration the clause that I want to deal with? And so it did. It said, here's the arguments, the potential solutions. It added another row about the clause impact to give you an idea of, you know, whether or not these arguments or counter arguments, how they're impacted. Like it says, the clause currently only gives the customer the right to terminate, things like that. So that was great. And then now I wanted to make it customized to me. So then I said, I'm in-house counsel and I want to object to this clause because it's one-sided. Can you outline a negotiation table that takes into consideration all of these things? And then it actually has put together a negotiation table for me based on my position and, you know, some provider favored solutions and then how it impacts the clause. So it's just, it gives you one, all again, all of these great ideas, new ways to look at it. It writes it in a very succinct way that you can use. I don't use all of them, but it gives you some good ideas. And then I just kept going because I wanted to and said, can you redraft the clause then with the above suggestions from the table? And then it redrafted the clause for me there. And then of course it always, I love it always when I'm asking it legal questions, it tells me to consult with the legal team before implementing it. And then I just kept going and asking it things. So you can go in there and see that, and I'll jump back to my presentation.
Now, Laura, what is the risk of hallucinations when using ChatGPT in the context of creating a negotiation table?
I mean, it can make things up, but then you'd know not to use, right? You would see that.
I guess it would be pretty easy to tell in this context, right?
Yeah. And I think really the hallucinations refer to more factual things, right? We're talking about case law. We're talking about people who brought defamation suits. It made up a story about someone. Here, I'm feeding it information and asking it specific information. So it is pulling from like its understanding of what is a termination for convenience clause, but that's why I did it in the methodical way that I did to see its understanding, right? Is it hallucinating? Does it even know what a termination for a convenience clause is? And I'm like, okay, it's doing pretty good. And then I keep going. And then as you feed it more specific information, it really should be tailored. But I'm not asking it for case law. I'm not asking it for factual information. I'm asking it more for arguments and specific points of view. And then you can discount those, take them or leave them.